Okay. Usha Kulkarni, she'll be presenting fetal growth restriction, an algorithmic approach. Bimal Sahari sir will be moderating the case. Sahani sir needs no introduction. Even though sir is moderating this case, he has done the complete background work of this webinar. Sir is a hardcore teacher and always ever helping and guiding us all the time. He is a great teacher. Sometimes I wonder whether he teaches the fetuses as well. He is the director of Sonoscan Center, Aurangabad. He is the president-elect of the Society of Fetal Medicine. He is the core author of the first and the second trimester guidelines for Society of Fetal Medicine. And needless to say, his area of interest are fetal growth and Doppler and fetal heart. Over to you, Manjusha.
Shall I start, sir? Am I audible?
Yes, go right ahead.
Yeah. Good evening once again. Today I'm going to present a case of early fetal growth restriction, a very common scenario in our day-to-day practice. But till date, every time I see a fetal growth restriction, I remember Bimal sir and his teachings because it's really awesome. This patient, Mrs. ABC, 22-year-old primie, presented to her obstetrician at 23.5 weeks of gestation for her routine antenatal care. Before this, she was managed at periphery by a general practitioner. Her first trimester viability scan was normal, corresponding to gestational age by LMP. NT scan was not done, uterine arteries assessment was not done. Anomaly scan, which was again done at periphery, was saying that there were no anomalies, but it had mentioned that there was a lag of 10 days. Sad part, its percentile values, growth charts were not given, they were not done. Since there was a lag of 10 days in gestational age and clinically the fundal height was less, patient was advised an early growth scan. She came to me for the first time at 26.4 weeks of gestation. For my fortune, there was a one-liner report of 10 weeks showing a CRL of 30 mm, which was corresponding to the menstrual age. So this was her first scan at 26.4 weeks of gestation, in which BPD and HC head percentiles were at the 14th centile, while the abdominal circumference and femur length were at the 8th centile. The baby weight was 822 grams, which at this particular gestational age was at the 9th centile. It was less than 10 centile. I called up an obstetrician, took his permission and did a Doppler evaluation. Now, these are the Doppler pictures, which clearly reveal that both the uterine arteries are showing higher resistance fluid, while rest of the vessels were showing normal flow with their normal percentile values. So here we have umbilical artery with 75th centile, fetal medial cerebral artery 63rd percentile, and CPR was well within normal limit at the 37th centile. But one abnormal thing over here was mean PI in the uterine arteries was raised, that was pathological at the 98th centile. So this is the, at the end of the Doppler, I had two things in my hand, that the estimated fetal weight, which is less than the 10th centile, and increased mean uterine artery PI. So by Barcelona staging system, this was clearly a fetal growth restriction stage one. And according to the algorithm, I suggested a follow-up scan after 1 week. This was a follow-up scan at 27th week, wherein the head parameters at the 11th centile, AC and femur length at the 6th centile. You can see the growth chart same with comparative study with the previous scan. And the estimated fetal weight was now this time it had come to the 5th centile for the gestational age. Doppler parameters, umbilical artery at the 86th centile had gone up, fetal medial cerebral percentiles had dropped down to 16th centile. They were at the higher range of normal limits, but the CPR had come down to 5th centile. Here we can see the flow in the ductus venosus was well within normal limits with a normal PI value. This is the gist of the report, wherein we can see umbilical artery centile 86, fetal middle cerebral artery 16 centile, and CPR at the 5th centile, again defining this baby at this particular time as the fetal growth restriction stage 1. So she was advised to follow up after 1 week. Now at 28.5 weeks, the obstetrician found that her BP had raised to 140 by 100 millimeters of mercury and there was urinary proteinuria. Rest of her investigations, blood parameters were normal. She was started with proper PIH care by the obstetrician. And she was sent to us for a repeat Doppler evaluation. This was the growth scan wherein AC gone down, wherein AC had gone down below 5th centile also. And the fetal weight this time was the 4th centile. Again, we can see the comparative charts with comparison with the previous growths. This was the Doppler. Now, the CPR had gone below 5th centile. But you can see over here, the ductus venosus flow pattern is well within normal limits, subjectively also, and objective also, it was within normal limits. So again, what we have that since the DVPI was normal, though the CP ratio was abnormal, DVPI was normal, again, she was staged at fetal growth restriction stage 1. We called the patient after 1 week again. Now patient decided that every time I get the same type of report and they call me after 1 week. So she decided that I will go after a sweet period of say 12-13 days. And she came to me at 31.1 weeks of gestation. What we can see over here, further deterioration in the growth parameters, wherein fetal weight was less than third centile of the gestational age. So this was the Doppler. Now, what has happened over here is the umbilical artery percentiles have gone up more than 95th centile. Middle cerebral artery less than at the third centile. CPR was at the first centile and ductus venosus PI again normal at the 38th percentile. So we again have the same thing. Though the fetal weight was less than third centile, CP ratio as the first centile, but again, DVPI was well within normal limits and hence she was again classified as fetal growth restriction stage 1 and again a follow-up after 1 week. Now she came to me again after a gap of 2 weeks. Ideally, she was supposed to come to me after a week, but she decided to come after 2 weeks. And what had happened over here that now the baby weight was 1480 grams, which for 33.1 week of gestation, it was less than one centile. You can see drop of the growth comparative study. And what we have in Doppler, it's something like this. There was absent diastolic flow in the umbilical artery. And ductus venosus, you can clearly see the A wave is deepened. And that's why giving rise to increased percentile values in the ductus venosus. So, fetal weight less than one centile, umbilical artery absent diastolic flow, and DVPI 99 centile. And this leads to classification according to Barcelona system as fetal growth restriction stage 3. Here, the ductus venosus acts as a trigger factor for delivery. That's why baby was delivered by cesarean section. A 1480 grams female baby was delivered by cesarean section, transferred to NICU and doing well till date. Now, during the entire process, it was a teamwork in real sense. The mother was managed very well. PIH part was taken care by the obstetrician very well. And later on, the baby was managed nicely by the neonatologist. Actually, a patient believed in her obstetrician and neonatologist both believed in me. And I just followed a simple algorithmic approach. Right from the first Doppler, wherein worsening parameters, but we could pull her up to 33.1 week of gestation. Right from 26.4 weeks to 33.1 week, wherein we could give a healthy, nice baby to the parents. So algorithmic approach and teamwork is very essential. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Manjusha. You can stop sharing your screen.
Yes, sir.
Your case actually is, a perfect case to the theme that we have for this panel discussion, and that is on the algorithmic approach to management of fetal growth restriction. And now we have another 25 minutes to go through some aspects of fetal growth restrictions. And I have a wonderful panel. I have Dr. Vijayalakshmi Ganorkar. She is a senior obstetrician from Nasik and into private practice since 36 years. She's held many posts in the MOCs and has been the past president of Nasik OBGY Society. And then, of course, she has keen interest in your education. And best part is her area of special interest is high-risk pregnancy. So she's an ideal person to be a panelist in this kind of a panel. Then we have Dr. Vijay Barve. He is a radiologist with special interest in fetal medicine from Nasik. And he has been into practice a very, very respected figure, not just in Nasik, but amongst the radiology community in the country. And he has been, he's held a lot of posts in MSBRI and the Indian Radiology Association also. Then Dr. Sanjay Aher is a neonatal intensivist from Nasik. He's done his DM neonatology from KM Hospital, Mumbai. He's done his fellowship in neonatology from Australia, Canada, and UK. He's going to give us the neonatologist's his opinion as far as FGR is concerned. Then Dr. Sinesh Kumar is, again, does not require much introduction. He is a fetal medicine specialist from Kerala. He's done his master's in maternal fetal medicine from Fetal Medicine Barcelona, and he's got a trilect fellowship in maternal fetal medicine from Italy. And then he's done his specialized training in fetal medicine from Simar Hospital at Edappal. And then, of course, Manjusha, whom we have already met, and she has taken us through a wonderful case, and she's the director of the Yashasri Diagnostic Center, Nasik. Now, we move to the panel. Now, before I really start asking questions, let me tell you all that there are three group of, there are people who fall into three different kind of groups. In one group, these are the consultants who have a complete understanding about the concepts of fetal growth restriction. You know, they understand all the perfusion and the diffusion and all those fancy things about it, but they do not follow protocols. Then there is another group which has very limited understanding of all these concepts, but they just strictly follow the algorithms and the protocols. And the third group is the one which has an understanding also and follows protocols also. That is a very, very small group. Now, the thing is, right in the beginning, I want to say is that this group A is very good, maybe for one occasional, very high risk, different kind of a case. But this group B, if you look at the overall results in group A and group B, you will find that the group B has an overall better results because they follow certain protocols, they follow certain algorithms. And that actually is the theme for this panel today. And I expect all my panelists to be brief and, just give us some simple insights into what everybody, everyone, every person practicing in whichever part of India can do. Lesser mortals like me can do in their day-to-day practice. Now, before we get into it, Manjusha, in your case, there was one thing which actually, when you said that, fortunately for me, there was a one-liner report which was available, which had a CRL, and by that, which was corresponding to your menstrual age. And you gave a complete one slide for that. What was the reason behind that? Why is that so important?
Yeah, actually, honestly speaking, sir, before I started her sonography, I was going through her papers and I was desperately looking out for that one-liner report at least, which can tell me her date of corrected expected date of delivery. Like dating scan is so much important. because it forms the major crux of all these fetal growth restriction problems. Had she not done the previous dating scan, or she had not shown me with Likert normal all the time, when she had come to me at 26 weeks of gestation and showing the growth of 24.4 weeks, if I had not seen that report, I would have totally missed that golden opportunity to classify it as fetal growth restrictions. So it was a golden report for me.
Thank you. So whatever we're going to discuss in the next few minutes is going to be about Doppler and everything. But let me tell everyone that all these things that we talk about, the PI is at the less than the fifth centile, or the PI is more than the 95th centile, all that is for that gestational age. And hence, for making any kind of a diagnosis of growth disorders, maybe the growth restrictions or macrosomia, if for everything, what is important is the accurate gestational age. And once you have an accurate gestational age, then only all your algorithms will work. And that is why the most important thing is to get your gestational age right and do your, you know, the dating scan becomes very, very important. And there was another pointer in that where you said that there was the lag of 10 days. That was all in the report, and there were no parameters, there was no percentiles, nothing. Again, a very, very important thing that when you are writing down a report, you know, there's no point writing BPD 20 weeks, HC 20 weeks, 2 days. No, what is important is BPD 48 millimeter. So whatever is the measurement, that is important, because anybody later on, when you want to plot your growth charts, it will be of no use if you don't use that. So very nice case, and thank you very much for that, Manjusha. Now, let us start the other way around. See, normally we involve the neonatologist towards the end. Now, we in this panel, we want to start off with the neonatologist. And my question to Dr. Sanjay Aher is, what are the immediate postnatal and what are the long-term abnormal outcomes in FGR babies? And I wanted to ask you one more question, because you are a neonatologist. Are we doing enough as far as diagnosis of FGR is concerned?
Thank you, Dr. Bimal and Dr. Manjusha Kulkarni, for inviting me for this scientific event today. These babies or fetuses are at very high risk of intrauterine fetal death and stillbirth because of chronic hypoxia and acidosis. There is very high risk of perinatal and neonatal asphyxia, and these babies can land up in long-term neurodevelopmental issues. Then, due to hypoxia, they have less risk of HMD as compared to premature babies. But due to remodeling of their pulmonary vasculature, they are at a high risk of chronic lung disease. And that increases their NICU stay and cost of their NICU treatment. Then fourth thing is hypothermia, because they lack subcutaneous fat and brown fat. So these babies are at very high risk of hypothermia. The next thing is hypoglycemia, because there is no storage of glycogen in the liver and muscle. So these babies also have hyperinsulinemia, and they suffer from hypoglycemia. And deadly complication in these babies is involvement of brain and long-term neurodevelopmental problems in these babies. Next thing is they also suffer from polycythemia because of chronic hypoxia. So it increases the risk for hypoglycemia as well as hyperbilirubinemia. So these babies need longer treatment for bilirubin phototherapy or HM transfusion. Sometimes they need partial HM transfusion. Then we are very afraid in these babies about necrotizing enterocolitis, because when there is absent diastolic flow or reversal of flow, there is ischemia of the intestinal tract, and these babies can develop necrotizing enterocolitis. And this is a very, very deadly complication in these babies, because sometimes they have intestinal perforation and long-term gut problems because of this. And last thing I would like to mention is fetal origin of adult diseases. Because of remodeling inside their vasculature and their endocrine system, these babies are very prone to develop type 2 diabetes mellitus as an adult. Then hypertension and obesity is also very, very common in these babies. So these are all the complications we expect in these babies. And I'm very proud that because of advancement in all these ultrasound and obstetric care, we are doing really well nowadays as compared to 10 years back. Now we are getting this diagnosis very early, and it is always better to fight outside the uterus rather than inside the uterus, because we know what is happening in the baby. And I will always recommend we should concentrate more on babies who are more than 28 weeks rather than focusing on babies more at a lesser gestational age, because the complication and prognosis is very good after 30 weeks or 28 weeks. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay. And so the message actually you're trying to give is that we just think of stillbirth. It's not just only about stillbirth. There are so many other things that a fetal growth restricted baby can have. Now, my next question is to Dr. Hello. Can you hear me? Yes, Manjusha, can you hear
yeah.
me? My next question is to Dr. Ganorka, ma'am. Madam, what is actually a small fetus? How do you define FGR? And how do SG and FGR differ in their clinical course?
At the outset, thank you, Dr. Sahari, and thank you, Dr. Manjusha, for inviting me to be part of this esteemed panel. And you, Manjusha, you made a wonderful presentation today. And as far as the small fetus goes, we all understand that a small fetus is one whose expected fetal weight falls below the 10th percentile. So that's a small baby for you. And in this group of small babies, you could very well just have a constitutionally small baby. You could have a growth restricted baby. Now we no longer say IUGR, symmetrical, asymmetrical, that is all passe. We only talk about a small constitutionally small baby or a fetal growth restricted baby. So in this small group, you could have one which is affected where there's some kind of internal infection. So whenever it is not a constitutionally small baby, we are dealing with an FGR. That is a baby which has failed to achieve its growth potential. And that is essentially due to a pathological process. Most often there are problems with placental perfusion. You have uteroplacental insufficiency. Sometimes you may have a baby with some intrauterine infection or some chromosomal abnormality. So that's the basic difference between a growth restricted baby and a small baby. Now, coming to your next question is how do they differ? Before we go to that, I want to tell you that sometimes you may have an FGR baby, which is not at the 10th percentile. But if you see the growth scans, you will find that initially it was growing at a good velocity, say maybe 75th percentile. And then there is a sudden drop and you find that the growth has dropped across the quartiles, across the percentiles. And this is also a growth restricted baby. Or you might just have a single criteria where you have some Doppler adjustments and therefore also you could call that a growth restricted baby. If you're talking how they do and how they compare, a small baby, they are basically small. So it's just a statistical deviation. So they have a good perinatal outcome. Their Dopplers remain normal. And we allow them to go to term and they often deliver absolutely uneventfully. But if you have an FGR baby, we must pick up this baby earlier because as Dr. Ahir said, they have a very bad or poor perinatal outcome. They land up with unexplained stillbirths. If you do their Dopplers, you see a number of Doppler adaptations from the umbilical artery to your middle cerebral artery. And they almost always have some kind of placental insufficiency, which is the cause of their growth restriction. And then depending on the severity of the and the staging of this baby, we decide when to intervene, how frequently to monitor, so that you give a good outcome and a healthy baby to the parents.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot. Now to Dr. Vijay Barve. So you have a small fetus whose estimated fetal weight is less than 10 centile. Now, madam said, yes, we need to differentiate between whether it's an FGR or it's an SGA. So how will you do that?
See, if they... Then, or if uterine artery is abnormal, CPR is less than 5th percentile, or umbilical artery PI is more than 95th percentile, we will call it a FGR baby. If expected fetal weight is less than 10th, but it is between 3rd and 10th percentile, and the Doppler is normal, then we can call that baby as a small for gestational age, and which is likely to have a less complications as compared to FGR baby.
So in simple words, it is fetal weight less than 3rd centile, okay. But if it is between 3rd and 10th, if the Dopplers are abnormal, it's FGR. If Dopplers are normal, we will label it as SGA. Thank you, sir. Thank you for simplifying it. Now, Dr. Sinish, is it important to classify FGR into late onset and early onset? And how are they different from each other?
Okay. Good evening, Team Nashik, and a big hi from Kerala. Before even I start answering this question, I must say I'm fortunate to be in category C of your initial classification of clinicians, because I've always hanged out with teachers like you, Bijoy, and all, and also I have spent a lot of time with the Basmala people. Now, the early FGR and the late onset FGR, they are actually two different phenotypes. So the difference starts from the very early process of placentation, where the process of placentation is severely affected in early onset IUGR. So what happens is the total placental surface that is available for exchange of nutrients is very restricted in early onset IUGR. So that is basically a perfusion defect. Whereas in late onset IUGR, the problem is more of a diffusion because the placental injury is very certain. Now what this essentially means is during the course of the pregnancy, the natural history is very much established for early onset IUGR. There's a gradual degree of hemodynamic adaptation followed by compensation, decompensation, and severe injury. Whereas the changes in late onset IUGR are very, very certain. And for example, changes in umbilical artery or ductus venosus dopplers are almost never seen in late onset IUGR. The preeclampsia is very, very less common in late onset IUGR. And what happens, this essentially means in third trimester is the problem with late onset FGR is in diagnosis, because the fetus may not be essentially small, and as already discussed, the placental injury is very small for the umbilical artery Doppler to be abnormal, and the hypoxia is not much. And this also means that the fetus is less tolerant to hypoxia. So just like the early onset IUGR, the late onset IUGR is also prone to develop stillbirth and poor neurodevelopment outcomes. Now, if so you follow the Delphic, yes, sir.
Yeah, so this 32 weeks, is it a rigid cutoff?
Sir, never. This is not. This is never a rigid cutoff, because this is actually the most useful cutoff to be used in third trimester because of the observation studies and last studies which have shown that, and there also it depends upon the timing of the third trimester ultrasound examination. But this is most useful distinction between the early onset and late onset IUGR, because most often late onset IUGR is diagnosed after 32 to 34 weeks. Whereas the early onset IUGR is diagnosed much before this. But to summarize, this is not an essential strict water stage cutoff.
Thank you, Dr. Sinish. So we had somebody directly from Barcelona telling us, so it makes a lot of difference here. Now, Dr. Manjusha, what is the consensus criteria to define early and late onset FGR? I'm not talking about the weeks, but how do we define them based on Doppler and other findings here?
Yes, sir. We have clear-cut Delphi consensus, and the same criteria are followed by ISUOG practice guidelines also. While we are discussing about early onset fetal growth restriction, there is a solitary criteria, either the abdominal circumference or estimated fetal weight, if it is less than third centile, or the umbilical artery showing absent end-diastolic flow. That can be a solitary criteria. Or contributory criteria can be abdominal circumference or estimated fetal weight less than 10th centile with either or uterine artery more than 95th centile, umbilical artery more than 95th centile. This is about early onset. And about the late onset FGR, solitary criteria is again AC or estimated fetal weight less than third centile, and contributory criteria. Amongst the all the contributory criteria, we have to have at least two out of three. So these are AC or estimated fetal weight less than 10 centile, AC or estimated fetal weight showing crossing of two quartiles over a period of time, or uterine artery PI more than 95th centile, or a cerebroplacental ratio which is less than fifth centile.
What do you mean by two quartiles, Manjusha?
Sir?
What do you mean by two quartiles? Crossing two quartiles so means what?
Quartile is 25%.
In simple language.
One quartile is 25%. So two is 50th percentile drop.
50 centile. So it is crossing. So it's, you know, from 80th centile, it can come, if it comes down to 30th centile also, it has crossed centiles, two quartiles. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, Ganorka madam, see, as far as management and decision-making in FGR is concerned, okay, there was a time it was totally based on personal experience. I just want to know, because you've probably gone through, because 36 years of practice must have taken you through all these phases. Is it still on personal experience, or have all the obstetricians also started adopting this algorithmic approach or protocols, ma'am?
The most obstetricians today are dealing with all these stage-based protocols. 35 years ago, when we didn't have Dopplers, we didn't have ultrasound, we used to just go on our clinical judgment, and often we used to err, sometimes on the wrong side. But today, when everything is available with us, and if we are aware, the moment we suspect clinically, we see a small baby or the fundal height is less, it should alert us and we should go in for a growth scan, which is around 30, 32 weeks or whatever time that you feel that the patient, you have detected a small baby. And then this helps you to decide whether it's FGR, it is SGA. And then depending on the stage-based protocols, it's very easy to manage. It's all quite simple, it's algorithmic, and you have to do your Dopplers. And in this Barcelona stage protocols, you can just fill in all your measurements and you get a good guideline. Now, very often when we have to tell our patients that they need to come every week for a follow-up, sometimes like Manjusha's patients, they don't come very frequently. But if you show them the protocol, you tell them like, this is what we are doing it for you, and this is what is advised by the International Society also, it helps us to convince them, and they do come back more frequently. You can monitor them, and therefore decision-making and timing of that delivery can also be managed better. These apps are available, and definitely along with your clinical judgment, if you follow these stage-based protocols, it helps you, you know, it helps you minimize your personal errors. And therefore, I don't think one should go on personal experience, and we should take use of all these protocols and algorithms which are now available to us. My only one observation is that they don't give too much importance to Likert. And as an obstetrician, we are all the time watching whether there's an oligoamnios, and that sometimes does affect our decision making, especially in your late FGRs. We do the CTGs also, we do the biophysical profiles. We don't like our babies to be acidotic. So along with this, it's a perfect blend of the clinical findings and your algorithms. But I would urge everyone to follow these algorithms and stage-based protocols for a better decision making process and management of these FGR babies, especially if they are presenting between 28 and 30 weeks, 32 weeks, you need to know when to deliver, not too late, not too early.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. So now we come down to, you know, the Barcelona's, you know, what are the staging? Dr. Vijay Barve, what are the criteria for the staging? There are four stages which the Barcelona team has given us. What are the four stages of Barcelona, Barcelona staging?
The most important part of the whole discussion is, as soon as you see a baby beyond 26 weeks, your Doppler should be always on. Because you don't know before putting your Doppler on whether it is an FGR or a small for gestational age. All the pathological correlation as well as staging depends on putting your Doppler of uterine artery, umbilical artery, ductus and aortic isthmus. As it put rightly on the stage one, which is a very early stage of smallness and mild placental disease, you can just get a fetal weight which is less than third percentile, but either of any one of them, like uterine artery, PI more than 95th percentile, umbilical artery more than 95th percentile, CPR less than fifth percentile or MCAPI less than fifth percentile. It will be a stage one. But again, the point is same. Put on Doppler as soon as baby is requesting you to put the Doppler on. If you go to stage two, there may be an absent end diastolic flow in umbilical artery, or it can be a aortic isthmus reversal. That is stage two. Next stage is stage three, where you may get a reversal of the end diastolic flow in umbilical artery, or ductal venosus PI will increase to more than 95th percentile. If you don't do your ductus regularly, this more than 95th percentile, which Dr. Manjusha has picked up, is very difficult to pick up. So even in each and every normal baby, you would see that you do a ductus at different stages of your gestation. Then only you will master that, and then you will pick up these small variations between 90 to 95, 85 to 95, and then you will intervene at the right time. So documenting ductus is very, very important at each and every stage of pregnancy. And the stage four is severe acidosis, where there will be a reversal of the ductal waveform and maybe associated abnormal CTG.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And Dr. Sanjay Iyer, do the clinicians involve you in the decision making as regards when to deliver?
Yes, I'm very proud that all the obstetricians, senior obstetricians in Nasik, they always involve the pediatrician and neonatologist in decision making. And that's why we are getting very good outcomes in these babies. And here we have next what question.
What is more important?
Yeah, if you ask me,
is it the gestational age or the baby?
Go for gestational age rather than weight of the baby, because when the baby is born premature, major three organs, his lungs, his eyes and his brain, is immature. So we are worried about not only lungs but also baby's eyes and baby's brain. If baby is born at 29 weeks with good weight, still that baby is going to suffer from all the complications of prematurity. And if you have baby who is born at 32 weeks of gestational, even though he is growth restricted, he will have better outcome as compared to baby who is born at 29 weeks, because there is very high risk of intraventricular hemorrhages in premature babies and retinopathy of prematurity. So I will always prefer a bigger gestational age baby, even though he's little bit growth restricted.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay. And Manjusha, can you explain the Barcelona protocol for surveillance and delivery decision for early onset FGR? Actually, Barcelona has not differentiated between early and late as far as this thing is concerned. But it works very well with the early onset, this thing. But quickly, you have only 30 seconds to...
Yes, sir. It all depends
on... We are overshooting on time. Yeah.
Delivery and surveillance monitoring. If it is a stage one FGR, then we have to take the baby up to 37 weeks of gestation, deliver at 37 weeks, and monitoring should be weekly. If it is a stage two FGR, then the gestational age at delivery should be 34 weeks, and monitoring should be bi-weekly. For stage three, gestational age at delivery 30 weeks, and monitoring at an interval of 1 or 2 days. Stage four, gestational age as delivery at 26 weeks and monitoring 12 hours, but we have to be cautious, as Sanjay Iyer sir mentioned some time ago, that while delivering such babies which are at 26 weeks, we have to be careful and we have to see what is the neonatal setup at our particular location.
But along with all this Barcelona thing, we also need to take into consideration there is something called the NST. You know, that is, again, there are certain things which we need to, the biophysical profile, all these things are actually important. But today, we are basically dealing with the Doppler, this thing. And this is one chart from Barcelona, which is just wonderful. And I think everybody should have it on their table. It not only tells you how you are going to stage them, and if it is not of that stage, how should you monitor it and what should be the mode of delivery. And this is actually works wonders with everyone. Now we come down to late onset FGR. Dr. Sinish, how do you manage surveillance and delivery decision in cases of late onset FGR?
Thank you, sir, for this question. And throughout this panel, we have been discussing about Barcelona Protocol. And as Dr. Vijayalakshmi has rightly pointed out, a very experienced obstetrician also finds that there are some other reasons where you have to slightly deviate from the protocols. So this Barcelona Protocol essentially came in 2014, and the late and as you clearly pointed out, late onset IUGR is put as stage one, where we do a weekly surveillance using Dopplers. Now, let me also point to all the audience and panelists here that two other guidelines have come in very recent times. The ICUG protocol has come in 2020, and just a month or two back, the FIGO guideline has come for the management, surveillance, and diagnosis of IUGR. Now, actually, they have kind of complicated the simplistic approach that Barcelona has advocated. But let me summarize you, if I can take a few seconds for this. Now, basically, what this IUCOG and what this FIGO guideline essentially adds up to the Barcelona protocol is that, first of all, there should be a multimodal approach in surveillance of late onset IUGR, where you have a clinical surveillance of the mother for any worsening of preeclampsia or any end organ damage. You should always ask the mother to perceive the fetal movements. To this, you add the biophysical modalities of CTG, that is NSG, or if you have the CCTG, which it's not available in any part of our country, and the hemodynamic indices of cerebroplasmic ratio, or even in recent times, the umbilical cerebral ratio also is also being talked about. Now, for an IUGR, which is for a severely growth restricted baby, that is where the AC or the estimated fetal weight is less than the third centile, or the umbilical artery PI is greater than the 95th centile, one should perform an CTG, NST, or biophysical profile along with the multivessel Doppler once or twice a week till 37 weeks. And once 37 weeks is crossed, you should do the surveillance protocol at least twice a week. Now, if the estimated fetal weight is between the third and the ninth centile and the umbilical artery Doppler is normal, then till 37 weeks, you do the multimodal surveillance once a week. Once 37 weeks is crossed, twice a week. Regarding delivery, the severely growth restricted babies, that is babies which are less than third centile, or where the umbilical artery PI is more than the 95th centile, which is also observed in late onset IUGR, delivery should be considered between 36 to 37 plus 6 weeks of gestation. If the ACFW is between the third and the ninth centile, or the MCA or CPRs are abnormal, consider delivery between 38 and not later than 38 plus 6 weeks of gestation. And if there is no contraindication to vaginal delivery, then induction of labor is possible. Only thing, add continuous electronic fetal monitoring, and mechanical induction of labor is a preferred modality rather than using prostaglandins. Now, in any surveillance protocol, whether it is early or late onset, you should always consider delivery irrespective of gestational age when you get a persistent spontaneous distillation in CTG, or when the clinical profile of the mother worsens, that is, if she develops a HELLP syndrome or severe preeclampsia or eclampsia. So regarding steroids, even though all protocols say consider steroids before 34 weeks, you can have a lesser threshold till 37 plus 6 weeks. And regarding magnesium sulfate, only if delivery is before 30 weeks, which is never ever encountered in late onset IUGR. So I know I've all somewhat complicated the Barcelona protocol by adding things from the ISUG guidelines and the FIGO guidelines, but they provide more holistic approach and they add to the simplistic approach that the Barcelona people have been advocating since 2014.
Yeah. Okay. The only thing is the Barcelona protocol spoke mainly about the computerized CTG actually. Yes, sir. The ISUAG and all, they have taken the conventional CTG also into consideration as far mm-hmm. as this thing is concerned. But anyway, a very quick reply is, we are totally out of time now. Shinish, what do you, as Dr. Ganorkar said, that not necessarily all FGRs will be SGA. You know, you can have an FGR which is AGA. So how do you go about with them?
So this considering a 10th centile as the only cutoff is a very myopic way at looking at the fetal smallness and the probability of developing adverse neonatal outcomes. In fact, babies even between 10th to 25th centile can have adverse neonatal outcomes. So one must consider that the fetal growth is longitudinal, That means there can be dynamic changes like what Delphi consensus says. There may be a fall of two quartiles or more than 50 centiles from the previous fetal growth centiles. And also, always, one should consider the hemodynamic concept into being. That is the cerebroplasmin ratio or the MCA, centiles into considering the fetal smallness and the probability of developing adverse neonatal outcomes. So it is not just that an absolute value of 10 is taken into consideration. Multimodal approach, considering adding the hemodynamic modalities should also be considered.
Thank you. And okay, we will skip this question that should a scan at 32 weeks or 36 weeks be a part of protocol in every pregnancy? I think all of us will agree that it is yes. And should a Doppler be a part of all growth scan? Again, the answer is a big yes from my side. And so what is the step-by-step approach always is assign a correct gestational age, identify a small fetus, do Doppler, distinguish between FGR and constitutionally small, stage the FGR and plan surveillance and decision on when to deliver based on protocols. And then, of course, that an objective protocol based approach actually works wonders as far as, you know, our Indian system is concerned, because we are, we have people practicing at very, very different places with, not necessarily with all the kind of infrastructure which is available. And then ductus venosus evaluation, of course, is the cornerstone for when to deliver in early onset. CPR is a critical index in late onset, and scans at 36, 37 weeks and 30, 32 weeks along with the growth scans are along with color Doppler are becoming increasingly justified in the low risk group. Thank you very much. Thank you, panelists. I'm sorry I had to rush you through because FGR is something you can speak the whole day about. But then, yes, we were going, overshooting on time. And thanks a lot. With this, it's back to the hosts there.
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
sir.
Yeah. So, do we move to the third panel or
we'll?
Khurana sir is there.
Yeah, I'm here.
I'll just introduce Dr. Khurana. What can I say about him?
Do we have enough time? We've
30 seconds.
But I think we've overshot a lot. And,
okay.